Good afternoon again. And, you know, I really don't use to brag, but we are at NTU, and bragging at NTU is a natural habit. So let me tell you that this is a conference where we have 15 Brain Prize winners. The Brain Prize is the equivalent of the Nobel Prize in the field of neuroscience. Five of the 15 have already received, and we hope to have another 10 in the future. So let's say there are 15 Brain Prize winners here, five already received, and five to become, and we will work on it. Anyway, the fourth Brain Prize winner of the conference after Jacobo and then Tamás and Peter is György. More precisely, György in Hungarian, George in English. György is the diminutive or nickname of György. Some people call him Yuri because that's more pronounceable. But György Buzsáki is, of course, coming again from a very famous stall, a neurophysiological school of Endegrascsán. And he has been working on things which we have already heard a little bit about from Wolf. Oscillations, synchronization of oscillations, and the critical issue, how these fine mechanisms can give rise to things which we call cognition, thoughts, and even consciousness. But Yuri will immediately tell me, no consciousness. Because I mistakenly told you a few minutes ago he will talk about consciousness. He shot me down and said, only about cognition. I just wondered, Yuri, how cognition is possible without consciousness, but I hope you will explain it now in your talk.
I'm sure the motivation was to try some new avenues and see how the conflict between these two societies or two approaches could result something interesting. So I thought about it a little bit, and I put a slide here, and I forgot to bring a bottle of Hungarian wine, but I promise you that if somebody tells me where I got these words from, we'll win a bottle of wine. Yeah, I can't promise that, but I can promise. So there's a list of items here, and this list is relatively long. Most of the words are familiar to you, and this is the vocabulary of cognitive science, and in fact, it's the vocabulary of cognitive neuroscience. The problem is that these words were invented by humans prior to the emergence of neuroscience. There was no word at this time called neuroscience. Anybody wants to claim for the bottle? Neuro? This was not written in this century. In fact, at least 100 years ago. By? William James, you got the prize, a bottle of wine. William James. William James, whose philosophy was, of course, British empiricism, and this is where all these words are coming from. Now, there is a strange thing here. The strange thing here is that these words have cognitive boundaries because we understand that perception and motivation, emotions, and so on are different in our world. And we take these words here, expressions, as independent variables, and we are trusting or giving money to cognitive neuroscientists and neuroscientists to work out mechanisms according to this list. How strange it is. It would be wonderful to know if there is such a list in Eastern sciences. If you have never heard about William James, if you never studied any in the European type of text, is there something in your vocabulary that would be similar or different? Can we build up a different world? And that's one of the things that I'd like to understand in this meeting. So this is all very complicated. As I say, this is a dead end. This will never lead to a complete understanding. It's because we got the independent and dependent variables wrong. So my goal, my entire research goal, is to reverse this trend. And I try to understand the brain from within. I take the brain or the brain mechanisms as independent variables and try to find words or descriptions for those independent variables. And this is what happened in molecular biology, computer science, everywhere except in cognitive neuroscience. So how do I do that? And I deliberately took a very complicated thing, which is at the middle level, I call it cognition, and I tried to explain from below, from the bottom. So let's start. The goal, or maybe the fundamental goal of every single brain is to predict the future. More precisely, to predict the brain's action or the consequences of its own actions. So the reason why brains can do this is because we live in a world where there are recurrences, there are regularities, and brains can exploit that regularities are out there. So if you take a simple nervous system, such as this imaginary one, the goal of this brain is to predict the future, and the way it does is that sends an output, for example, moves a sensor, and then if something interesting happens that comes back from the sensor to the brain, it can adjust the machinery in there, so next time the similar circumstances occur, then predicting the future will be a little bit better. This is called plasticity. Now, the interesting thing about this, or the sad thing about this, that this very simple organism can predict the future in a very short time scale and in a very simple environment. Now, what happens over the course of evolution is we add a few complications to this. We add another neural loop here, another neural loop here, and we keep adding, that is evolution, I have this one, keeps adding loops, one loop after the other. The entire goal of these complications is nothing else but to predict the future, but now at a much larger time scale and in a much more complex environment. Now, this, of course, this learning can be both evolutionary learning as well as individual learning. Now, what happens at one point, of course, it never happens at one point, but at the key moment here is that this learning process becomes very smart. The algorithms get so smart that at some point they no longer need the outside world. This is what I call internalization of function or disengagement from the environment. And the moment the brain disengages from the environment, it is so smart that now it can look into its own computation. It can examine what we call what-if scenarios. What if I will go to the left or to the right? What if I would finish graduate school or I don't? Without actually moving, without any action. And the brain can do it because it collected a lot of experience. So in the rest of my talk, what I'd like to do is to show you three examples about disengagement of various functions from the environment or from the body, or internalization of initially functions that are depending on either the body or the environment. So let's start with something very simple. Everybody knows, every mother knows, and every father knows that baby kicks are very, very important. In fact, if you ask the gynecologist, they all tell you that it's very important because even we have only 5 scores, from that number, you can predict how fit the newborn will be. In fact, there is a correlation between IQ measured at the age of 20 and the Apgar score at early on. So, of course, what we would like to know is that what this movement buys for the brain. Why is it good for the brain? Luckily, we can examine this because there is the rodents are born pretty early. They are outside the womb, but they correspond at birth about the transition between the second and third trimester of pregnancy. And as you can see, they kick. This is what they do for a living. They are like popcorn that, you know, sometimes the gastrocnemius is stretching, sometimes there is a limb movement, and sometimes there's a whole body startle reaction. Again, you ask, what is it good for the brain? So this is the question that could be investigated very easily. But in fact, when we asked this question, we didn't even know about this connection, what I'm going to tell you about. We just wanted to see something fundamentally important, namely, what is the first organized pattern in the cortex that emerges through ontogeny? So we put in electrodes early on after birth, and we waited to see if there is anything interesting. So what you see here is an electrical activity recorded from the brain. This is firing of the neurons, in another way of expressing this, and the movement. And you can already see that if you zoom in from here to here, the first pattern is a spindle. And if there are people here who are familiar with the EEG, they would say it looks like a sleep spindle. Except that this is not a sleep spindle, because classification of brain states at this early age is almost impossible. And in fact, every single one, this was our finding, every single one of them is associated with some kind of a movement. Every single time there is a movement, there is multi-unit activity, and then there is an early spindle. Just to tell those of you who would like to know what sleep spindle is, sleep spindle happens when we are completely immobile and we are in bed, and it happens at a particular transitions of sleep. That is, requires no external environment. Here, we need an external kick here. So what is early on, of course, is there is nothing, and all of a sudden, from out of nothing, brain activity emerges. In fact, it turns out that there is a nice topography. At this very early age, the brain is vertically organized, which means that the very fast-conducting IA afferent from the spinal cord go to the thalamus. From the thalamus, the thalamocortical fibers already go to the cortex. But the long-range cortical connections are not in place yet. There is no cognition, no consciousness, or no perception. Nothing is possible because the brain circuitry is not there. But the vertical organization allows that the activity goes up. So at this stage, the cortex is like a mosaic structure, and no wonder we get this very beautiful topography. So if the forelimb is twitching, then we have a representation that corresponds to, where is the forelimb? Somewhere here. And if it's the hindlimb, then we will have a very different representation here. And we can go on and show that, indeed, if we cut the spinal cord, for example, then all of a sudden these things disappear or decrease tremendously. In other words, there is a pattern, early spindles, that is depending on fully by inputs from outside the brain. So why is it good? To make the long story short, I don't have time to tell you, but in a nutshell I will try. This is a mechanism to learn about your body. The brain, when it is born, has no clue whether your body is a snake, a ball, or the way it is. It also doesn't know whether you are growing. So a baby at 1 week is trying to touch the nose. It's a different action than 2 weeks, because there is a longer arm and then the distance is larger. So there has to be an update. And this mechanism is a good for update. So how does it happen? Imagine that we have 650 or so muscles that mammals have. And we just put them right here on the floor. There are lots of muscles, and they are connected to the brain. And they are twitching independently. Then the utility of this is exactly zero. However, in an animal such as us, the muscles are connected to the skeleton. In other words, their degree of freedom is decreased tremendously. And for a good future use, because the flexors are always working together with other flexors and an antagonistic way with the antagonist muscles. So now we have a spatial layout of the body. This is reflected by the temporal patterns that occur at the same time if they are coming from the same part of the body. And this way, in a large amount of time, which is about a second or so, which is the duration of this, can assure then that when the long-range connections and the subcortical connections come back, then grow, then they go to the right place at the right time, because they will be co-activated. Those neurons or those that represent the different parts of the body, they never fire together. Therefore, they will not wire together. This, of course, is not only in the rat, but you can also measure it in premature babies. Premature babies don't feel, don't have consciousness, no matter what you hear. This is the claim. It's because there are no long-range connections there. Most of the time, there is no brain activity. And all of a sudden, when there is a movement, there will be a sleep spindle-like phenomenon. So when we did these experiments, we made a claim that indeed, in order to have that, you have to generate an output first. You have to look at the consequences of the output. You have to register it and see what the consequences are. And of course, these are very adaptive systems. And we wondered if we can do an experiment where we would deprive, for example, an animal from an output. Let's say cut the facial nerve or do something like that. But it turns out it's not really necessary. Nature provided these experiments for us. You can ask questions, what would happen if you had an extra limb? Or if you have an extra head? Or what if you had two bodies? Or what if you have two bodies and one brain? And things like that happen, and here's an example.
Twins, I think, to our...
Tatiana and Krista Hogan are what's called craniopagus twin Cochrane,
twins
from pediatric neurosurgeon.
They have connections amongst blood vessels, both arteries and veins, but they also have this connection between their, what's called the thalamus, and between the thalami, one in each.
They are very interconnected. they share a lot of things normal conjoined twins don't. They have the special abilities to see each other, see what each other's seeing
they
through each other's eyes.
They have the special ability to see each other's.
During this haircut, for example, watch Krista. Is she seeing through her sister's eyes?
I have seen several movies of them.
You think they do share?
Oh, I definitely do. I definitely do.
Felicia holds a pencil where Tatiana can't see it and asks her to grab it.
One in mommy's hand.
And watch closely here at Tatiana on the left while Felicia strokes Krista's arm.
You know, when you were rubbing her arm gently, she started smiling. And she had an expression like she could feel it.
Yeah.
So you got the point. This is a very interesting fusion. There are two bodies, 1.5 brains. They are fused together. And they have boundaries that they can switch on and off voluntarily. When you ask, when you touch Tatiana's hand, you ask, Krista, what happened? He said, you touched Tatiana's hand. Even though the body is represented in both triple hemispheres, if you want, but at the same time, they have got personal boundaries. They are two different people fused into one. Now, tell me how this is possible with evolution only. Tell me how it is possible without experience only. Tell me how it is possible without action only. The reason why I'm showing, I've shown this, although, was that this was my first example of a very effective mechanism that is there to build your body picture. But at the same time, it also shows very nicely the simplest, perhaps the simplest possible way, how you can disengage from the environment. By day 21, when the rats wean, that they go out from the nest, and they have their subcortical neurotransmitters, sleep becomes the way how it is in the adults, and then the spindles will be confined to particular brain states. It will never go again while you are here, as long as you are awake. However, it doesn't disappear completely. If you go home tonight, not home, but to your bed, sometimes you will see that you have this large startled body reaction. You almost fall out of the bed. If you allow me to record from your EEG, I can demonstrate you that there is a nice spindle there. So this is one example. The two other examples I'm going to show you are from spatial navigation. Spatial navigation has a lot of necessary ingredients. The most important one of which is head directionless. When you come to New York, I haven't been in the subway in Singapore, but let's say somewhere in Singapore, you emerge from the subway station, you have a map in your hand. In order to use the map, you need a few things to know. First of all, you have to orient the map. This is what the head direction system does. If you do it wrong, then you keep going down a mile before you realize that you are going in the wrong direction. The second thing is that you have to tessellate, you have to read out where you are. You have to locate the buildings from relative to you and yourself with the help of the grid system. And this is what is shown here, except in a regular map, it's squares, whereas here, as the Moser group has shown nicely, it's a 6-degree equilateral triangles. And finally, you have to locate yourself relative to the other things, and this is the place cell system in the hippocampus. So let's start with this system, and the reason why I like it is because this is the simplest possible sensory system that exists. Why am I saying that? First of all, it's not listed as a sensation, but it is. Our direction or sense of direction is one of the most important things we have. So there are neurons in the brain that fire when I look at the clock. And as long as I'm looking at the clock, those neurons will fire forever. There is another set of neurons that is sensitive when I'm looking at that corner or that corner. And when I turn around 360 degrees, for every single degree, there will be a set of neurons that will be telling me that these are they represent my head direction. This is the way how I can use it as a compass. But of course, if I'm going to another room, that head direction system will be a very different one. But again, their relationship will be kept with each other. So this system cares about nothing else except where your head is directing to. In contrast to complicated things like in V1, where you have orientation selectivity, you've got contrast, you've got intensity, and lots of other things that are the different neurons coding each of these a little bit. Color, here there is only one thing. So how this comes about? Wolf already introduced you the idea of labeled lines. So the idea is that it comes from somewhere in the vestibular system, and then it goes to the brainstem. From the brainstem, it goes to the mammillary bodies. From the mammillary bodies, it goes to the thalamus. It's called the AD nucleus. From there, it goes to the limbic system. It's called prosubiculum. Then it goes to the entorhinal cortex. It goes to the parietal cortex, lateral septum. Lots of places. Lots of places. So it's represented in a lot of places. So this reminds me of a nice story, another name that was mentioned already by somebody today, Sherrington. Who is familiar with the name Sherrington? Anybody under age 30, 40? Well, Sherrington had a hobby. His hobby was to figure out why a cat lands on its feet. So he threw up his cat, and it always lands on its feet. It said, this is called the writing reflex. And he wanted to know, what is the input to this? So he said, oh, it has to be the vestibular system. He cut the vestibular system out. Nothing happened. Then he said, oh, the eye. So he blindfolded the cat, threw it up, nothing happened. Then he cut the muscles in the neck and so on. He went on and on and on until eventually said, you have to do at least 7-8 manipulations simultaneously before you can kill this very complicated reflex. But the point is, he said that if something important is evolutionarily important that is represented at multiple levels in the brain. So the head direction system is one of those Sherringtonian entities because it's represented everywhere. So these neurons are assumed to be driven by the external world. So if this is the case, then you can ask a very simple question. Let's record from these neurons. And one way of doing that is putting in not electrodes or not wires, but our specialty is using these silicon devices. And then we get this picture. From this, you can record from the so-called local field potentials, oscillations, and so on. And then the action potentials, and you segregate individual neurons. It's sparsing out the players of an orchestra. Once you have that, you can do this experiment that I talked about. And this was already done by Gene Renner a long time ago. What you see here is a bunch of neurons from the AD nucleus of the thalamus and the posterior subiculum that are tuned very specifically to a particular direction. And they may be driven by the vestibular system, the neck, the eye, and all the other things that are allowing you to have this sense of direction. So what we ask is, if this is true, that the head direction system depends on the input from the outside world, what will happen if we switch off the outside world? And there is nothing easier than doing this, because all you have to do is wait until the animal falls asleep. Once the animal falls asleep, the vestibular system is inert, the neck muscles are not very active, vision is not there, nothing is there. And this is what you observe. So this picture, what you see here, is this where the animal is awake. These are a bunch of neurons. Every row here is a Morse code of a neuron. And then this is the the head direction of the animal that you can detect with the small LEDs on the head. So whenever the animal moves the head, we know exactly which direction the animal is looking at. And then we can train a neuronal network or a computational network from these population firing patterns to predict which direction the animal is looking at. And this is the result of that trained network. And you can see that the correspondence is gorgeous. It's absolutely beautiful. It's because these neurons have enormously good signal-to-noise ratio. So what happens when the animal falls asleep? In the other way around, this animal was sleeping and then it woke up. So what happens during REM sleep is that you can see that there is no chaos. There is no disorder. In fact, the neurons follow each other exactly the same way how they do it in the waking animal. In other words, representation of 30 degrees is followed by 40 degrees, 50 degrees, 60 degrees, 70 degrees, and so on. And this happens during REM sleep. So we can tell exactly where the animal is looking while in REM sleep. More exciting is non-REM sleep. What happens there is that the order remains the same. The sequences, you can call it a ring. This is a ring attractor. The activity goes around this ring attractor independent of the brain state. However, during slow wave sleep, the pattern is a little funnier. And the reason for that is because the activity around the ring goes 10 times faster. And this is very good news for us because we have shown in the hippocampus earlier that replay of learned information happens about 10 times higher speed. So indeed, this system is enslaved to a larger entity, that is either neocortex or the hippocampus, is controlling the speed of this activity very effectively. Well, the rest is just proving what I have already told you. These are examples that if we have two neurons that are representing the head directions towards the loudspeaker, they are overlapping in space. Therefore, they overlap in time. Not surprisingly, their cross-correlation in time will be positive. One neuron that is looking at that loudspeaker, the other neuron is looking at another loudspeaker. The animal cannot have the head at two places at the same time. Therefore, they have a negative temporal correlation with each other. So if there is positive correlation and there is negative correlation, there must be a zero correlation somewhere. So indeed, this is what we looked at. Every single line here is a neuron here, actually a neuron pair. And when the neurons are positively correlated because they have an overlap, and these neurons are negatively correlated, and the transition happens at about 60 degrees. And I can show you it in various ways. In fact, it does not matter whether I look at this correlation or calculate these correlations during waking, REM sleep, non-REM sleep. I'm looking at the AD nucleus, the posterior cubiculum, or one neuron in the thalamus, the other one is in the posterior cubiculum. The result is the same. And the transition always happens at about 60 degrees. Now, if you remember, the grid cells were so special because they were equilateral triangles. And the Mosers and several other groups are looking for the explanation and the mechanisms in the entorhinal cortex. And they don't find it. And the reason why they don't find it, because it's not there. It is perhaps already there and fed to them by the head direction system. And 2 years ago, it has been shown by a group from New Hampshire that if you lesion the head direction neurons in the AD nucleus, those famous grid cells are completely useless. So this system is driving the rest of the map that is needed for spatial orientation. So now, back to my story, or back to my original question, is that what is happening when you take away the external environment? How much damage there is to the system? And the answer is not very much, because what we can do is calculating the predictions where the animal's head is by looking at various time windows and the various cross-correlation different states. And what you see here is that, indeed, during waking, the prediction is best. But when the animal is asleep, this is not so bad. In fact, the gain that you have here is only 30% or so. a large percentage of this computation is given to you by the internal organization of the brain. So what happens here is that nature worked out a mechanism with the help of the external environment, and the neurons respond to it. In fact, this is exactly what happens in a moth or in a cricket, that the environment is determining, and the neurons respond to this, but the moment you turn on the sun, for example, all of a sudden the activity will be either chaotic or there will be no activity whatsoever. But here, the activity continues. So what is it good for? Well, the good thing is that I can close my eyes, and I still know which direction I'm looking. So there is enormous amount of possibility for interpolation and extrapolation. And those loops that I showed you initially, they serve nothing else but interpolate and extrapolate. That's the whole thing about machinery, because that allows you to expand your horizon in longer time and in a more complex environment. So that's what we learned about head detection system. Now let's move on to place cells. Place cells are very unique because it localizes itself all the time relative to the environment. So for example, when I move from here to there, there will be place cells that are active at almost every single step. If it's a red, then you can see that there will be a sequential activity of neurons firing one after the other. And the wisdom is, the reason why these neurons fire sequentially, because place cell one is sensitive to the environmental constellation. Let's say this cue is very important. The animal approaches this cue, the corner of the podium, the firing rate goes up, and by the time the animal passes it, then the firing goes down. That is, these neurons are driven by the environment, and the reason why there is sequential activity is because imposed upon them by the external visual inputs. This is an idea like in V1 that the external world is driving them, or potentially by idiothetic information from the body, that is counting the number of steps, whatever, but in both cases, the information comes from outside the brain. So this is a great idea. There is an alternative. The alternative is that this internal, the sequential organization is due to an internal dynamics. It has very little to do. It could be updated by external cues, but if there are no external cues, then it will go on nevertheless. And this, of course, is a very important thing. It's because if the hippocampal cells are place cells, and the hippocampus is all about spatial navigation, then I don't exactly know how I can tell you this story. The reason why I can tell this story that I'm telling you is because I think at the beginning of my talk, when Balaj introduced me, there was a cue. That cue allowed me to start my talk. It ignited a cell assembly in my brain, which in turn gave that information to another cell assembly, and another cell assembly, and another cell assembly. And I can stay here for 24 hours, and I can tell you something continuously, because these cell assemblies self-organize themselves one after the other. So here's an example of this thinking. If you ask people who are recording from the hippocampus, such as O'Keefe and the Mosers, they will tell you that hippocampus is about navigation. Luckily, interestingly, there are two forms of navigation. One is what you can call map-based navigation, the one I already mentioned you. The other one is idiothetic kind of navigation, or you can call it also dead reckoning type of navigation. What is it? So if somebody brings me into this room, and you switch off the lights are off, everything, I have no clue where I am. I start exploring the environment, and then I bump into an object. And I can turn around, and using my idiothetic information from my body, I can come back to the same place. Then I go somewhere else, I come back to the same object again, said, this is a node. And I keep collecting nodes, and more nodes, that is more objects I see in the environment, the clearer the layout of the environment can be. Then if this is a simple environment, I can go outside, I take a piece of paper, and have a sketch or layout of the room, which will be a map. Then I can give a map to you and to anybody else, and then you will have this information for you because you can read a map. The take-home message is that in order to generate a map, you need dead reckoning type of navigation. Without exploration, there will be no map. So the information goes from here to this direction. Now, if you ask cognitive scientists, they will say, no, the hippocampus, entorhinal cortex, and so on, they are not for navigation. They are there for memory, especially for memories that we call precious memory or important memories or episodic memories, because these are what makes us who we are. These are our experiences. It also comes in two favors, though. This is the episodic type of memory, and the other type of memory, which is independent of ourselves, because it's shared among the community. So everybody knows this is a podium, this is a pointer, this is a microphone, and so on. These are names of things. And this is what's called semantic information, and Wolf talked about it extensively. So the good thing is that there is a relationship that also the same. In order to get a semantic information, first you have to have, or most efficient, to have an episode. If you see a dog in your first time in your life, that's an experience. That's an episode. Typically, it happens early on in your life, so you don't remember any more the spatial condition. But if you see another dog and another dog, and you see tons of dogs, then it becomes just a dogness. It becomes a noun that will strip off all the spatial temporal conditions that were associated with that knowledge, and it becomes an abstract knowledge. But the information I'd like to convey to you is this. Nature figured out a mechanism to use a machinery in the brain for guiding the animals around in space with the help of external cues. When the machinery becomes smart enough, then you no longer need that, because you can navigate mentally back into the past using the same navigation machinery. So when you are navigating in the real world, you get into a wall, then you know because of your map that you have to bypass it. So when you automatically can generate detours, or when a new road comes in, you can find a shortcut and so on. And this is the same kind of thing that we do mentally when we travel back to the past. But in fact, it's the same kind of machinery that is being activated when we are traveling into the future. So we usually separate in our minds planning and recall, but in fact, it's supported by the same mechanism. So why is the hippocampus so effective of generating these sequences and this kind of knowledge? Well, it's because it's a very beautiful structure. It also has a extraordinary strong connectivity that you may remember, again, Wolf showed a beautiful map of connectivity. The limbic system was up there, and the top of that is the hippocampus, and the top of that is the CA3 pyramidal cell. What you see here is a CA3 pyramidal cell. This is the cell body, and all the white stuff is the axon of this one single neuron reconstructed in the in vivo rat brain. So you could see that it's a three-dimensional layout, and you can see here that this one neuron can cover two-thirds of the, or one-half, sometimes two-thirds of the entire structure, and it's quite remarkable what you see here. About 80% of all the connections in the hippocampus are coming from within. So what the hippocampus cares about mostly is itself, and it cares about itself if it's perturbed a little bit and its stable state is perturbed a little bit, then it responds right away. Also, if you look at this distribution, it's also interesting because you can see here is that the probability that this neuron fires, is connects to a neighboring neuron is pretty much the same than somewhere else far away. So it's almost like a random graph, an extremely dense graph. So there are about 200,000 of these cells, 200,000 of CA3 cells in the hippocampus. If you need a complete graph, that is every neuron should be connected to another neuron, all you would need is one neuron is connected to about 16 other neurons. And then you would have a complete connectivity. However, if that was the case, then if you would like to go from one place to a randomly chosen other one, then sometimes you have to go through multiple neurons and long path that will require a long time. Instead of 16, every CA3 pyramidal cell is connected to about other 60,000 other neurons, which means that now any neuron can visit another neuron in just two steps. And that's very short time. In fact, that can take only about 100 milliseconds, which I equate with the hippocampal theta oscillation time, or as Peter mentioned, that's the LMDA time constant. So I show you compressed here about 60 years of very hard work in our field by the very best people. And Peter Schumann, you already alluded to it. I'm showing you a play cell. So this neuron, as you can see, it fires somewhere here, and then we can turn it into a map and so on. And then there are other good things about this. If I show you two neurons, then you will see that there is an interesting relationship between the two neurons. So there is a green neuron and the red neuron. And then when the animal is moving along this track, the width of the, or the length of the blueness shows here how fast the animal goes. If it's large, the animal runs very fast. If it's slow, then it goes very slow. So you can see that the distance representation between the green and the red neuron is about 80 centimeters. And this is represented also in time, as it's shown here, by the buildup of this cross-correlogram. The green neuron here is the reference neuron. And then whenever there is overlap here between the firing of the two neurons, that overlap happens to about 80 milliseconds in time. So distance is re-represented in time in the hippocampus through the machinery, what is shown here. So the remarkable thing here is that you probably noticed that it doesn't matter whether the animal goes fast or slow, the temporal offset is exactly the same. So time does not change, even though the speed of the animal changed. Now we can do another trick. The other trick is that we can record from two neurons and measure the representation of these two neurons with a scale, with a ruler, and said this corresponds to about, 40, 50 centimeters. And I learned from Bruce McNaughton and John O'Keefe, if you put the animal in the larger environment, then these two neurons are shifted apart a little bit more. So then I ask, it's very interesting, because if you put the animal on a 1 meter track, and then all of a sudden it will be a 2 meter track, the two distances will be different. What happens with the temporal representation in the brain? And the answer is, the answer is nothing. The temporal representation will remain fixed, although the spatial representation varies. And I can show you this more quantitatively. There are about 15,000 cross-correlations shown here, and this is the short track and the long track. So what did we learn from here? What we learned from here is that there is a finite representation that the brain can do. And that happens in a single theta cycle that corresponds for the animal, for spatial representation, let's say about 1 meter distance in the dorsal hippocampus. In order to resolve the rest of the universe with equal resolution, the animal has to move forward. And then the next meter will be resolved again. And then you have to move and you have to evolve. In fact, if it happens beyond 100 centimeters or beyond 100 milliseconds of time, then you can see that it's 2 meters and infinite is on this sigmoid scale. So there is no resolution there. So why is it interesting? Well, it's interesting because this is exactly what happens in our cognitive sphere. That is, we have a working memory and we have a long-term memory. Long-term memory is extremely rich. All our resources are there. But we just pull up one memory, and then it becomes a working memory, and we can work only with 7 ± 2 items, and that mechanism allows us to do that. I remember very well what was my previous slide, and the slide before, and the slide before, and I know what's coming up for about 7 slides or so. But all the rest of the talk is sort of a smoggy area. In other words, in order to for a memory to come, become aware, you have to pull it up, put it in the hippocampal prefrontal system to make it possible that we actually know what we are. And when we would like to move forward with our story, then we have to have another sequence, another sequence, another sequence, and one neuron after the other, which is meaning that the sequential activity of the neurons have to go forward. There's another important thing that I showed you, namely that it is the time constraint that is a primary thing in the brain, because This is what is not changing. Everything else suffers from it. Everything else is a consequence of this. So if you put an animal into a small cage, then the resolution of that cage is pretty good by the same number of neurons. And the distances between the place where representations are small. But if you put the animal in an environment of a football size field, then all of a sudden the spatial representation by the same set of neurons will be very, very poor. The same happens in our memory system. If I ask somebody, tell me the list of items from William James' table of contents, don't forget your bottle of wine, then you can tell that. Then I said, okay, zoom into chapter 5. Zoom into the most important thing. These are all individual memories that allows you that you zoom in and zoom out, and the hippocampus is such a zoom to be able to do that. Now, the work on navigation was awarded by the Nobel Prize. And the reason is very clear, they are fantastic discoveries and so on. And the reason why it was so powerful, because it was a good theory. And good theories can be recognized right away because they can give you very good predictions. And you can test those predictions. So there are many predictions from the spatial navigation or map-based theory, but one of them is this. If by some miracle you can freeze an animal, let's say a rat, here and now in time, and by some magic you can maintain the theta oscillation, that the theta dynamic constant, then the theory predicts that there will be neurons in the brain, in the hippocampus, that will fire forever as long as the animal is in this particular part of the Cartesian space. Every other neuron will be silent. If you move the animal to another spot and the theta activity is maintained, there will be another set of neurons and everybody will be safe. In other words, those neurons that represent the here and now should fire forever. So we tested it in the following way. This is a spontaneous alternation task where the task for the rat is that if it turns to the right, it will get a water reward and said, I came from the right. Now the next one is I have to go to the left. And if you insert a delay here, it becomes a hippocampus-dependent task because it's this sequential activation of the cell assemblies that allows the animal to bridge time and remember what happened in the past and plan for the future. So what we ask from this animal is that in order to spend 10, 15, 20 seconds here, please run always in the same direction and perhaps with the same speed. And the reason why we ask that is because we wanted to make sure that during the waiting period of time, there is no change in the external environment and there is no change from idiotic cues from the body. So we have done everything in our realm of our possibilities to keep the input to the brain constant. So let's see the prediction. These are four different neurons and multiple trials, and from these multiple trials we can make a session mean, so every line here is a session mean firing of the neuron. So what you might expect from the theory is that there will be neurons, such as this one, that every single trial should be firing as long as the animal is running. And all the other neurons will be silent. But what you see here is completely different. What you see here is that this neuron fires always at about 3 seconds. The other neuron is 5 seconds. The other one is 6 seconds. This is about 15 seconds or so. And then when we have enough number of neurons, many neurons fire in a sequential order. And their lifetime is the same. It's about half a second to a second. And this is exactly the same lifetime as if the animal would be navigating in the environment. So in fact, I can give this train of spikes to anybody who's working on spatial navigation, and there would be no way that they would tell whether the animal is getting somewhere or is running in one spot in the environment, which is in the wheel. Now, the good news about this trajectory, which is nothing else but the travel of the activity from this n-dimensional space of the CA3 axon collateral system that I showed you, then this trajectory is going in a particular direction. The good news about this trajectory, that it has something to do where the animal came from and where the animal is heading. So we have to be able to read out from the past experience of the animal where the animal will go a few seconds later. So I show you a single neuron that is capable of doing that. So this scratching sound is there's action potentials. They are not so elegant as the monkey's beautiful mirror neurons, but nevertheless you heard that. So when the neuron was firing, the animal made a left turn, and there was no spiking whatsoever. Now the animal made a right turn. Again, firing, then you can make a prediction from the previous observation, the animal is going to the left. It comes back again, there will be firing. So the animal goes to the right. So everything is fine so far. Now, let's see what happens here. Again, it's firing, then the animal will go to the left. Now let's see what happens next. So now everybody knows the game. Firing, left. No firing, right. So now let's see what the prediction is. If we do a Bayesian decoder based on behavior, your 100% probability or the prediction is that animal will have to go to the right. If you do it on the firing of the neurons, then it's still the same prediction, except that this animal is doing something funny now because it's running longer than needed. And I just heard a spike. Another spike. Now we are hesitating. We say, well, should we believe this neuron or should we believe the Bayesian prediction? And so the neuron tells the animal and the partners of these neurons that please go to the left because that's what I think is the right answer. It's a commission error that the animal makes, and then if the commission error is encoded already from the previous. So there is no firing now. We predict if it's a good trial, the animal goes to the right. Now let's see what happens last. There is firing, the animal has to go to the left. But look at what happens. It goes to the right, it comes back, the neuron fires and said, oh, go to the left, and it goes to the left. So this is a wonderful neuron, but not very useful for guiding action. The reason why it is not very useful is because it fired at the beginning of the trial. And there is another 15 seconds or 13 seconds that has to be bridged by some other neurons. Luckily, there are many other neurons that can do this trick. For example, this neuron fired early, this neuron fired selectively later, this neuron fired selectively at two places, and therefore, if you look at many, many neurons, this a few hundred neurons, you can see that if we sort the activity of these neurons based on a future right turn or a future left turn, then it doesn't need a lot of statistics or a lot of speculation. You can look at any slice of time and you can tell with high confidence, with 90% accuracy, whether the animal will make a right turn or left turn 15 seconds later, including commission errors. So the readout of the decision of the animal, if you want, I don't use this word because I don't know what it means, but we can read out the decision of the animal much, much, much earlier than before the animal goes to the so-called choice point. So once we have that, we can go back and revisit our claim here. There are two competing hypotheses, or were two competing. One is that there is sequences are imposed upon the brain by the external cues, either from the body or from the environment. The other alternative is that the hippocampus just cannot help. This very strong recurrent connectivity is just doing nothing else but generating sequences. In fact, when the environment is interesting, that this sequence, this trajectory can jump. So for example, I'm giving this talk, my trajectory is very clear, I'm looking at the clock and so on, but then Balazs will interrupt and then my trajectory will jump because the external environment is doing this trick. So anyway, we can do one thing that we love to do in the lab at this after long work, which is reject somebody else's hypothesis. So at the time when we were doing these experiments and we were ready to submit it, then I was in Hebrew University in Israel, and luckily at the same time, a neurosurgeon by the name of Itzhak Fried was visiting, and Itzhak is famous about putting electrodes into the hippocampus and can record unit activity from human patients. And I said, well, you know, I've got tons of neurons, you've got one or two, typically, but you can ask a lot of questions. So if a trajectory is something like this, and you have only one neuron, then you don't know what is the unique thing about this neuron because it's embedded into a trajectory, but you can ask a lot of questions. And many times there will be no response because this neuron is not part of that trajectory, but sometimes it will respond. And this is exactly what they did. And I show you the first part is absolutely just repetition of the experiment that we have done in a very primitive way because they have only one neuron. But the second part is interesting. The second part is interesting because our claim was that this is a sequential activation is a substrate of episodic memory. And very proudly, you know, I can declare this. And in fact, I traveled to Toronto. I talked to Enver Tulving, who coined the term. And I said, we solved it. I said, there's no solution here. Because the key of episodic memory is in the recall, in free recall. And there is no way I can test my rat about free recall. We need a human to do that. So the second part you will see is the humans can do free recall. And let's see what Isaac Fried found in his patients. Dr. Popel talked about anecdotes or single patient discoveries. This paper was rejected actually twice until I tried to intervene that on the basis that it's anecdotal. There will be only three patients, in fact, only two good neurons. But these are very important neurons. Anybody in this room can tell that there is something interesting happens here. Remember June 12th,
the power of the force.
Don't try to frighten us with your sorcerer's ways, Lord Vader.
So in the second appearance of Tom Cruise, the neuron fires again.
The famous couch jump.
And because you are all intelligent observers, you can already know that, you know, this is another appearance of Tom Cruise. It goes on and on and on and on.
You are gone.
This is an entertaining demonstration of exactly the same thing that we have done in the rat.
He did his best, but in the end, John Paul II could not utter a word.
But now what happens is that there are no pictures, no movies. The patient is asked after a few minutes, what did you see? So there is spontaneous recall. And in fact, the spontaneous recall is pretty powerful because the time scale is very short. And you can already predict something interesting will happen here. In fact, what will happen here, if you look carefully, is that first the neuron will fire about 200 milliseconds before there will be an utterance. Okay. So now what I try to convey you is that initially, nature worked out an algorithm. The algorithm was to navigate in the environment with the help of cues. But when the machinery got complicated enough, then you no longer need to rely on environmental cues. You can do the travel by looking at your own computation. And this is what I refer to as cognition, or you can refer to here simply as traveling back to the time or traveling forward into the future. And in fact, what happens with this compression mechanism is that these are the representations in real time, this is about 1 second or so here, of seven different or eight different place cells. But those different place cell representations are compressed into a single theta cycle. And in fact, in this single theta cycle, there are about seven plus minus two gamma cycles. And every single gamma cycle contains an assembly of neurons that come together for one and only one reason, which is to discharge the postsynaptic neuron whose integration time constant is in this range. But then it will give this information to the next one, and next one, and next one. So you can call it this a neuronal letter. This could be a neuronal word. And then you can concatenate the words into neuronal sentences. The here and now is always presented by the most active cell assembly. But this representation of this one very active cell assembly is helped a little bit by the representation of the past on the descending phase of the theta, as well as the representation of the future on the ascending phase of the theta. So if you recall the problem of how you define the here and now by Thomas Aquinas, then you can say, well, I know where the past is, I know where the future is. So we can put it in the context and we can define where we are, it's the present. So what is interesting here, of course, is that this sequential compressed mechanism is the theta cycle. And why is it is so beautiful after one after the other? And the answer is that there must be some delays here. And I give you, I have five more minutes. I gave you the answer here is that the answer is feed forward inhibition. So now we turn into another species. It's a mouse. It's another technology that Peter Chomagy already introduced a little bit is optogenetics. With the help of optogenetics, we can label specific set of neurons. In this case, we can label a set of neurons that are targeting the perisomatic region, another group of neurons that are affecting the distal targets. This is not so clear. Peter would shake his head and that's all. But by and large, they are different because mostly targeting the proximal areas or the distal areas. And then what we can do now is look at what happens to the place fields and the place cells when transiently on one trial we turn off the perisomatic interneurons, or another trial we turn off, in another animal, we turn off the dendrite targeting interneurons. In order to do this, there are multiple ways of doing that. One way of doing it is in a head fixed animal. This is almost a virtual environment. And then you can see that there are these little objects in the bell. The environmental cues are different. Therefore, again, O'Keefe's prediction would be that there would be neurons that are firing constantly, and then all the others would be shut off. But that's not what happens at all. Instead, what happens is that if this represents 150 centimeters distance of the bell, then if once we have enough number of neurons, then every part of the belt is represented by one assembly of neurons. And this is a nice sequence or a trajectory in this n-dimensional space of the CA3 system. There is another trial, and then in many, many trials, it's exactly the same. And there you can see very beautiful sequential activation. So now we ask, what happens when we turn off inhibition? And I have to hurry up a little bit and summarize it in this way. So every line here is a neuron. In a control situation, every single phase of the theta cycle is utilized by a given assembly. So it will be as many possible gamma cycles as possible, because these are the number of items that determine how big distance in the environment can be represented, or how many memory items can be pulled up into conscious level or awareness. And the order of the sequential activity is very important because it's a complex representation of the environment or complex representation of what I'm trying to tell you. However, when we shine light and silence perisomatic neurons, then all of a sudden those neurons that fired late go to the trough, and those neurons that fired early, they also go to the trough. In this experiment, we estimated that we silenced less than a dozen or so basket cells around each place cell. But there are many more basket cells from distant sources, so we wonder if we could turn off inhibition, perisomatic inhibition completely. What you see here, a lot of neuron would be firing, and in a very short time, let's say 5 milliseconds around the trough, and then you would call it an interictal epileptic spike. So that would be, of course, not very good for transmitting information. And in fact, this is also probably not very good for transmitting information. We have done other experiments with pharmacology where we showed that the sequences are essential. So the idea here is that sequential activity that is compressing the representation at the slowest timescale, just like in the Bach's fugues, for example, where we can look at a slice of time and look at the sequential activity of the score, and you can make a good prediction what happens in the next 10 seconds, or sometimes what happens in the next tens of seconds. So I didn't discover it. You know, Buck was smarter than many of us. But when you don't allow the sequential activation to happen, then all of a sudden the activity is scrambled, and the downstream readers from the hippocampus cannot read out what was supposed to be called information. Okay, my time is up. So let's go back to where I started. The idea is that indeed the most important goal of the brain is to predict the future. That is to predict the consequences of the output of the brain and test the hypothesis of the brain with some feedback with the help of the sensation that we provide this way. And then, of course, the prediction can be done in a very short time scale with a very primitive machinery and in a very simple environment, or in a more complex environment with a more complex machinery. And if I have to put my money somewhere about where cognition occurs, then I would say this is the time, or this is the mechanism at the moment, and it's another moment, it's an evolutionary moment that is probably millions of years, is when disengagement of the brain happens from the environment. This is where we can call the emergence of cognition. And basically, this is what I wanted to convey. Of course, I wasn't doing all this by myself. There are many, many smart people who were very constructive in this. Thank you.
So I cannot see others. Just thank you, Stanislas. Yes, Stanislas.
Come back.
Hi, thank you very much, Yuri. It's just a beautiful lecture. Just
this
a comment.
Is a very serious question.
That's the beginning of a serious question. Well, maybe it's a very general question, but I was a bit surprised that you defended the model of a sort of chain of firing, where you said, for instance, I start to give this lecture because I get a cue, and then another cue follows another cue, and that generates my lecture. I think that's not at all the way it's generated. And this model was already criticized by Carl Lashley in a famous paper on temporal sequences. Undoubtedly, certainly in humans, you have to consider that there is a hierarchy and a plan. Surely you have a plan for your lecture. It's not a specific word that cues the next, but it's a hierarchy of generation at many different levels, including chunks that are probably minutes long. And in fact, I was wondering if the beautiful mouse example where you had firing, you know, 15 seconds before the animal would start to move is not proof that there is also such a plan, rather than sequential sort of condition chains.
Yes, so some people would say, oh, this is a nice example of this infire chain idea of Moshe Abadi's, but it's not. This is happening in a very strongly recurrent system that Wolf already alluded to, that it provides persistent activity. What makes the cortex so effective in doing these things, that one spot, one change, can have a very long-lasting activity. Now, when I'm talking about neural syntax, of course, neural syntax is ordering of letters to make a word, but there is a lot of high-order patterns, especially when you construct sentences. I'm very confident that it exists in the brain. I know it is there because you know, because we perform according to those rules, but discovering second order or higher order interactions with 100 neurons at the moment is not an easy thing. So it is mostly a technical problem rather than denying the importance of higher order patterns. On the other hand, I can tell you that cross-frequency phase coupling, which is a beautiful demonstration of the hierarchy of brain rhythms, probably does exactly that. So
at the cortical level, I would expect, for instance, that in prefrontal cortex, you would find posterior to anterior organization, where you would have slower and slower, higher and higher level planning as you go more anterior. And is there any evidence for this sort of topography also hippocampus, for instance?
Some evidence is available. So for example, what I've shown you is the most primitive, simplest possible demonstration, because I was recording from one little spot from the hippocampus, which is the dorsal part. But in fact, yesterday, we already mentioned several times that there is a traveling wave of this pattern, and there's a traveling wave from CA1 to CA3. There is an activity that probably also travels from one structure to the other. So this is a three-dimensional representation out of which we just got one spot. So the closest thing to your answer is that this sequential activity is hippocampus origin. But whether the animal, whether the trajectory will be representing left or right may not be coming from the hippocampus, but from the prefrontal cortex. At the same time, when we published this, we published another paper, which is the sequential activity of prefrontal cortical neurons doing exactly the same thing. And later, maybe Moser had a nice paper showing that if the conduit from the prefrontal cortex to the entorhinal hippocampal system is transiently inactivated in the thalamus, it's called the reunion's nucleus, then this left and right decisions are very much compromised. So, you know, I'm very chauvinistic. I'm talking about the hippocampus. In fact, I talked only about the CA1 recordings and a little bit of CA3. This is a whole machinery that goes together very well. And cognitive neuroscientists, various places almost simultaneously discovered that those structures that you just mentioned that are active during memory recall are the same structures that are active when a person is imagining something or is planning something for the future. So you are absolutely on the point.
Thank you.
So Wolf is the next one.
Okay. First a comment to the ongoing discussion and then comes the question. There was, of course, since Joachim Foster, the idea that short-term memory was also this loop of traveling activity that maintains and bridges the retention interval. Now, this seems to be not the case, because what one sees is that in the retention interval, if one recalls from prefrontal neurons or parietal neurons in this loop, there are long pauses and there are bursts of gamma activity, Earl Miller called them the gamma bubbles, that occur at regular intervals in the theta cycle, and there's no activity in between, nothing that could bridge it. They are synchronized to theta, which gave rise to the idea that there might be some short-term synaptic plasticity occurring in the sense of a plan that is fastly induced, has a fairly long time constant, and does not require maintained activity in order to be supported. But this is just a comment. The question.
Let me reflect on this comment, which is very interesting, because in fact, what Wolf is saying, that it's not only spiking activity, but there are synapses. I call them synapse assembly. You know, synapse assemblies are very important because their time decay is much longer than the spikes, of course. And this is exactly what happens. We have a manuscript under preparation where we show that this 1 second time is in fact due to the transmission between pyramidal cells and interneurons. And one set of interneurons, which are perisomatic and possibly the bistratified neurons that Peter described, they are suppressing synapses. So the more the place cells fire, the less the transmission to the interneurons will be active. So one assembly is active. It's controlled inhibitory mechanisms that are shutting off the competing assemblies are weakened. Therefore, the competing assemblies can step in and do things like that. So the mechanism for what you are alluding to is probably short-term plasticity between pyramidal cells and interneurons.
Yeah, I think that's a viable hypothesis, because there's not enough work done on the short-term activity-dependent, contingency-dependent synaptic plasticity. Everybody has looked for LTP, but there's something else in the beginning.
A good example is the up and down states in the neocortex, that there's absolutely nothing for sometimes 100 milliseconds or 200 milliseconds.
So, but the question that I had, you mentioned that the CA3 recurrent collateral connections would be random. Now, it refers to the question that was asked or discussed this morning on the pepper and salt organization of the rodent visual cortex that lacks this columnar clustering. And still, these connections may be very selective. So if you have a random network, you assume it must have learned something. Because there's a lot of synaptic plasticity in CA3. I mean, this is the place where it has been discovered. Do you think that the circuitry is built and shaped and reshaped dependent on experience, or do you think it's a canonical circuit that just produces these sequences always? Because if it's random, it should not produce such nice sequences. How do you get the sequence regularity in there?
Symmetry breaking is a very simple thing in any nervous system. Yeah. So, but the answer is that yes, there is learning induced plasticity. Nobody can deny that. But I think if you look at in terms of wiring, that's very, very, very minimal. It's mostly Hebbian synaptic plasticity, that is, the synapses are larger and smaller. And we had a paper last year in Science where we showed it's the weak synapses that are the ones that are plastic, and the strong synapses are rigid. They don't change, and That's how I conceive it. That there is, in fact, the way I'd like to imagine this, and this is what we discussed at lunch, is that there's no such a thing as that the environment imposes things on the brain and the brain changes accordingly. Instead, the brain has a dynamic that is independent of the experience, and many, many, many patterns are there. And from this realm of possibilities, you can choose any of the pattern that happens to be active at the time when experience, what you call experience, happens, and then be assigned meaning to particular events, to particular sequences of activity in the neurons. So there are many, many other possibilities.
One, two, three, four.
Yeah, based on what you just explained, I recall, especially in the marsupial experiment. Marsupial, when they are born, they are perhaps about less than 20 days from the uterus, they know how to climb to the pouch. And at that point in time, the cortex hardly exists at all. So I would like to hear an explanation for all this. Yeah, place, cell, and so forth. How do you reconcile all this? How do they are able, if it's an external body like a computer program, that tell them where to go? And the experiment is done in such a way, they killed the mothers, so that the pouch will be distorted, but they somehow the other, the marsupial will not be end up in the pouch if they tilt the mother back. If the mother has to sit upright, and they will climb right and sit into the pouch. So I want to hear your view on that. Thanks.
So the right answer is, evolution is smart. It takes care of all of these scenarios. Marsupials have a different niche. They have different needs. They do things they need to. If they are born very early on, the nervous system is taking care of it. The other answer is, a related answer, that's such a simple thing. The brainstem is capable of doing a lot of things. You don't need a neocortex for that. In fact, in my early life in Hungary, I decorticated females for various reasons, and because of the not so good caretaking of the animals, some of them got pregnant, and they raised children just perfectly well. So a mother without any cortex was capable of raising children. So I assume that it's reciprocal, that you don't require a lot of things to suck, to stand, to walk, and so on. Many other things can be solved in a very simple way. And this is what I called this morning the good enough brain. The good enough brain is helping you to get by as far as it's a simple environment, it's a protected environment. You need to have the complex machinery when the environment is getting a little trickier, there are predators, and so on.
Okay. Thank you for the nice lecture. In the middle part, you had this short path and the long path, and your point was that since the time is the same, you have to compress the bigger path on the same, which means many things. Is you lose resolution, you have not a constant representation of speed, and so I'm sort of wondering what your view is, what happened during the evolution when we came down the trees and we walked over long distances in the savanna, and how this system then performs. Is it then that it only has a very coarse representation, that suddenly now the distance becomes 1 kilometer, or I don't know what, or we use a different system? This is what I would think, but I want to hear your view.
So that's a very relevant question. What I know, what I learned, is that the living niche of a rat, at least in New York City, is less than a half a mile.
Yeah, exactly.
They don't go anywhere else. In nature, this is typically happens except when they have to migrate somewhere, and then it's a very costly venture. So maybe that's enough for an animal. It has to have the layout in a very simple way. Migratory birds, like pigeons, they probably have a very poor resolution, but they can home, so they can have a very large scale. And maybe the zooming is very different in an animal that requires large representation than in a small representation, but the idea is probably exactly the same. So if you look at the dorsal and ventral hippocampus, for example, in the there is also a zoom from the dorsal hippocampus represents the very small place fields, and next to each other, the ventral hippocampus can have 10 meter long place fields. So even in the rodent, you have the possibility of representing simultaneously well, good and large, So we can tessellate the environment with small tiles and large tiles. I can say nothing about a proof or nothing about recordings from larger animals. Chinchillas have been recorded from, nobody recorded from cats, monkeys, but they are stationary. There are no play cells. In humans, there is virtual reality.
Yeah, but that's the problem with virtual reality, is that in fact it copies a sort of small environment and therefore it doesn't prove anything. So your question is very important.
Bats. What I was going to say to your question about the marsupials is that there are different solutions. The reason why this is so important in the hippocampus to have this hippocampal theta oscillation is because you would like to pack information, and then you have to have an end signal of the punctuation, which is the inhibition that comes at the end. But that can be solved in a different way. So for example, bats, they don't have theta oscillations. Zero, they don't have it. Everything else is perfect, but they have something else. They have echolocation. And in fact, every single theta cycle, every single oscillation, it has a gain and a perturbation phase. The gain phase is when the activity is high and the activity is together. This is exactly what happens with the place fields after every single echolocation, that the first 100 milliseconds or so after an echo is sent out, that the crispiness of the place fields are better. And so that's the answer. What is the size?
I mean, the point is, you know, how can we use the rodent as a human model? That's my question, and that we have no solution for. I can see your point that different animals have other systems. That's all fine. It's the question is, you know, we always say this is a model for the human, and I'm not sure.
So you have to be smart and careful and say, oh, this is the limitation of the system. But here's my enthusiasm. With both, we have written a nice review saying that the reason why we are interested in timing so much is because timing didn't change in the mammalian evolution. Every single oscillation is exactly the same. Mm-hmm. The gamma is gamma, sleep spindle is a sleep spindle, the up and down states are the same. Not only that, but the dynamic length, for example, a sleep spindle lasts about half a second or so in the tree shrew and in the human monkey, and also in one of the cetaceans, which has a very large brain. So time management is number one. Why? Because the integration time of the pyramidal cell is the same, upper time constant is the same. The muscle speed does not change over the evolution. It's about 50% change between the cheetah and the mouse. So we are controlling the same motor system. There is no need to change. What we have to do is coordinate the system. And this is where the complication comes in, because it's a 17,000-fold increase of the volume. And there, but you have to deliver information from the parietal and the occipital cortex at the same time back to the thalamus. It requires very fast conduits. And that's a lot of costly solution. But
just a brief comment on the bats.
Yes.
Because Ulanovsky has these long flight trajectories where he follows them with telemetry. They go 20, 30 kilometers all the way out to Tel Aviv from Rehovot. They certainly don't use echolocation to update their place fields. But what he told me is that even though they have no theta rhythm in the classical sense, what they have is they have oscillatory activity, they have phase precession in very much the same way, but it is chunked very much like in primates also, where you don't have this nice sustained rhythm, but you have bursts of activity that are periodic, but during these bursts you have the same sequence order repeated. So maybe you don't need this regular rhythm, you could get away with some...
Exactly.
Yeah.
What is important is timing, but the first one is, I have to say something, because Uha Nahum does not say at all that
sorry, we have a timing issue. You talk about timing. Judy, we have a timing issue. We have two questions. We are promised to answer two questions. Apologies. Probably we should go on with Peter's question. And
you are the boss.
Well, sorry, I am only the timekeeper. And I have a boss also. So, Peter, go ahead.
There is no time. I don't ask a long question. I just make a short comment. And thank you for your thought-provoking presentation, which is provoking almost everybody. And you contrasted your approach to brain research to probably most of those in the room who work on memory and emotions and things that have been labeled by certain words. So my comment is that these words have proved useful and survived and will survive and go on because they are just labels for brain states, which you said you study because you are looking for the goal of the brain. But brains don't have goals. Only organisms have goals, and the brain serves the organism. So now we have to ask, what is the goal of the organism? You know, human as well as non-human, and there is one goal ultimately, to make copies of themselves and multiply, and we are very good at it.
And you can do it with very little amount of brain. In fact, it's not always necessary to have a brain, but I'm very pleased that I happen to provoke you, so here's another provocation. Goal is a very important word. Without this concept, you don't understand anything in biology. Because without goals, there is no way to understand anything. The problem is, of course, as Peter points out, there are no goals in nature. But it looks like post hoc that there was a goal. And that's the catch 22. So I'm not using goal in a sense that there was a goal for evolution. Evolution made something out, but in order to explain it, it looks like a goal. And this is the way how we usually use it in neuroscience. And in fact, does anybody know where this term entered in neuroscience? Who used the term goal first? Well, I'm surprised, to me at least, it was in Moscow. It was an East-West Congress that I don't know if Wolf was there, many prima donnas from the West were there, and the, you know, the entire Pavlovian idea is that there's nothing else about anything because it's a passive association of CS and US, but they agreed on one term which was goal, and that was goal-directed movement, and it was decided by the apparatchik saying that we have five-year goals, we have five-year plans. Therefore, it was okay that the brain have plans. So this is a different use of what I'm using, is because it looks like we have a plan. It looks like evolution has a plan, but it's not.
Not evolution. The individual has a goal. Each individual has a goal, and it used to make copies of themselves.
Okay.
And all the rest just serves that goal.
Peter, if that would be the goal, then we would need no more than 100 neurons.
Sorry, we have to economize.
Very similar to, just Bill,
last
if you
question,
change,
last.
If you change the goal, would the scientific conclusion change?
If we change the goal?
Yeah, you stated very clearly, and I think this is picking up on your point, the goal of the brain is to predict the future. Very firm comment. Oh, I mean, I can buy that. Yes. But if we change that and said maybe it's a different goal, maybe, you know, if we took a existential Buddhist approach, it's not
Absolutely.
About past, present, future, it's about,
Absolutely.
You know, would it change, but would your scientific conclusions change, or would the scientific conclusions that you've very powerfully presented be the same?
It would be absolutely different. And the reason why I know is because the goal of the brain, prior to what I claim to be part of, which is the goal, is to associate. It's the part of the brain is nothing else, just to learn about the world, to perceive. But that's the wrong track. This is what I try to advocate here. Because if you take that track, if your axiom is that the brain's goal is just passively wait and learn about things because we are so smart, then the mechanism that I'm trying to understand will be very, very difficult to understand.
So Buddha had a very different view of the world.
It's a totally different view. You can't avoid consciousness as a concept if you are looking at the brain from the sensory input. It's not a perception action cycle. It's an action perception cycle.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm afraid we have a goal here, namely survive today and reach tomorrow, because tomorrow is yet another day and another conference day. So I would like first to ask you to come 9 o'clock sharp and stay the whole day tomorrow, because just as today and yesterday,
the tomorrow will be also very exciting. So we will start with Friedrich's lecture and go on until Henrik's lecture, and very interesting lectures by Stanislas and anyway, many excellent scientists tomorrow. But let me thank you, Yuri, for this fantastic lecture, and thank you for the audience for this fantastic, the questions and the stamina to stay.